Hi, I'm Wendy Leebov, partner in the language of caring. I've had the privilege of participating in what many of us now call the patient experience movement for well over 30 years, and I'm happy to share my perspective on the movement's exciting evolution. When I entered healthcare, patient rights and needs were certainly near and dear to care and service providers. Most hospitals had departments or individuals who served as patient relations specialists or patient advocates, responsible for risk reduction, handling complaints, helping with advanced directives, and troubleshooting with distressed patients and families. Then, in 1982, Medicare reimbursement rules changed for hospitals, and this pushed the patient experience from patient relations into the boardroom and C-suite. Rather than reimbursing hospitals whatever they charged to treat Medicare patients, the new model paid hospitals a predetermined flat rate based on the patient's diagnosis. Suddenly, patient volume mattered. Hospitals had to attract more patients since they received limited dollars per patient. And hospitals began to compete for patients. That's when the concept of patient as patient transitioned into patient as guest or customer. And that's when hospitals initiated what they called guest relations or customer relations strategies. Leaders wanted employees to realize that patients pay our paychecks. And they wanted employees to cater to patients' needs in order to be provider of choice. In many organizations, patient relations specialists stepped into an expanded role as overseer of these expanded strategies. And their professional association began to expand their programming and resources to address guest relations, not only patient relations. Meanwhile, patient survey companies sprung up to provide hospitals with ways to measure patient satisfaction, and thus began the use of systematically collected feedback to monitor customer satisfaction and guide improvement. Hospitals looked to hotels like Marriott and Ritz-Carlton for strategic insights. They set behavior standards, they trained staff in customer service, and they introduced hotel-like services, gourmet menu options, softer linens, valet parking, private rooms, and much more. And strategies shifted. Organizations began undergoing culture change initiatives to shift the mindset of everyone in the healthcare team from a provider orientation to a customer orientation. But the words guest and customer offended many doctors and nurses, and these words failed to engage them. Also, these words were too limiting, since service to coworkers or internal customers, vendors, health plans, and physicians were also important to hospital viability. So many of us began to shift our language to include service quality or service excellence, not just clinical quality, as part and parcel of the healthcare product. The consumer public didn't judge hospitals on clinical quality. They didn't know a good x-ray from a bad one, but they sure knew whether someone was rude or kept them waiting. Increasingly, healthcare boards and leaders recognized the primacy of service quality as the basis for consumer and physician choice of provider. And service excellence emerged as a top priority on board and executive team strategic initiatives. And to this day, many organizations continue to have departments of service excellence, directors of service excellence, and service excellence strategies. Also in the 1980s, motivated by the growing authority and power of the Joint Commission, healthcare organizations embraced continuous quality improvement as necessary to their short and long-term success. Strategies shifted to address service processes, not just amenities and people skills. Since many service shortcomings and suboptimal clinical outcomes resulted not from individual people, but rather from the failure of processes that had been poorly designed or never intentionally designed at all. Many organizations integrated service strategy leadership into their quality departments, while others strengthened their training and organization development functions to drive and support quality and service improvement. While some hospitals made significant improvements, some saw their service improvement strategies fade as flavors of the month. While perhaps effective in the short run, their effects diminished over time. And that triggered a widespread realization that a patient or service focus required a culture change. No longer could strategy leadership be delegated to individual departments like patient relations or training and organization development. The executive team had to take the reins and drive cultural transformation. Meanwhile, the Institute for Patient and Family-Centered Care, Plane Tree, and relationship-based care were attracting attention as more clinical people embraced the importance of engaging and empowering patients and families. These movements developed along with service excellence strategies, but did not yet integrate with them. Enter HCAHPS. Changes at the federal level created a sea change of attention to patient perceptions of their hospital experience. Starting in 2002, the Federal Centers for Medicaid and Medicare Services partnered with the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality to develop and test the HCAHPS survey for use in controlling spiraling healthcare costs and increasing accountability for healthcare quality. HCAHPS created new incentives for hospitals to focus on the patient experience. First, consumers could look up the scores of hospitals within their locales and compare one to another. Then, the Deficit Reduction Act of 2005 added another incentive for acute care hospitals to participate in HCAHPS. Since July 2007, hospitals on the inpatient prospective payment system had to collect and submit HCAHPS data in order to receive their full annual payment. And soon after, the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act of 2010 included HCAHPS performance in calculating value-based incentive payments in the hospital value-based purchasing program, first implemented in 2012. The trend toward greater accountability in healthcare has compelled greater attention to the quality of the patient experience. Value-based purchasing, accountable care organizations, HCAHPS and CGCAHPS, physician pay for performance, all of these compel our boards of trustees and other leaders to care very much about the patient experience and to implement strategies and devote resources to improving it. And there is a worldwide movement afoot. The Institute for Healthcare Improvement's triple aim includes patient-centeredness. The Beryl Institute is growing like crazy as the professional home for patient experience champions. The huge network of VA hospitals has adopted patient-centered care as a top priority nationwide. The Beryl Institute, the Cleveland Clinics Association for the Patient Experience, the Institute for Patient and Family-Centered Care, the Schwartz Center for Compassionate Healthcare, Plane Tree, New Zealand's Hearts in Healthcare, the Royal Society of Medicine in the UK, and many more. These are all attracting patient experience champions in droves and advancing the patient experience. What began as patient advocacy as a discrete function has evolved into enterprise-wide patient experience strategies, spearheaded increasingly by a chief patient experience officer. This movement, while aligning perfectly with these economic and marketing forces, is driven by an epidemic determination worldwide to personalize the patient and family experience, to engage patients and their families, and to ensure compassion in the patient-caregiver relationship. The movement is pushing patient experience to its most likely future stage, transformation. We are all determined to make healthcare wellness care, not only illness care. We all want people to engage and care, to be people-centered and patient-driven, reliable and compassionate, because we know that this results in the best possible health and well-being for people. We have come a long way, and there's a long way to go. Together, we can accelerate progress toward a truly enlightened, effective, humane, and participative healthcare system that works for everyone.